even if they think it, don't open your mouth to say it. There are certain lights you should never see yourself in, no matter who sees you that way. That really, practicing peace allows you to identify the thoughts that come to steal your peace. But if you don't practice peace, you won't even know when your peace has gone. So, this morning, I want to finish what I started last week. We are talking about this topic of excellence this month of October, ministry-wide. And last week, I started to talk about excellence from the perspective of the way we think. That to have an excellent life, you need to have an excellent way of thinking. That excellence is beyond the surface. It's beyond what you see. It's beyond the packaging. It's beyond the presentation. And for us as believers, our walk in excellence cannot even start without us renewing our minds, paying attention to our mindsets, taking care of what's going on in our minds. You know, when we got born again, we started off perfect in the spirit realm. But in the mental arena, there's still a lot of work to be done. There's a lot of work to be done. And it's beyond just being educated, you know, getting more degrees and more exposure to things in your field. It's beyond knowing all the facts and figures. But it's aligning our thinking with how God thinks. So last week I finished with, you know, a few steps, a few keys, tips, if you will, on how to train your mind for excellence according to God. So I'll run through that and then I'll go into the new material I have this week. Number one, find out how God thinks. Find out how God thinks. How do we know how God thinks? We know how God thinks through His Word. Number two, speak God's word to yourself so you get a sense for how God speaks versus how the devil speaks. It's very important. God told Joshua in the book of Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, He told him to meditate. It will not depart from your, this book of the law will not depart from your mouth, but in it you will meditate. Amen. And you will see, you will observe, and to make your way successful. Meditation is very important, but meditation is not just in the mind. There's also a muttering to yourself. That's a part of meditation. You need to hear God's word come out of your mouth. Amen. You need to hear God's word. You need to hear what it sounds like. You need to speak it and speak it in context. You need to get a feel for the material of God's word. So that when you hear the fake, you know it's fake. Because the devil does quote scriptures as well. He quotes scriptures. The only thing is that he will quote it out of context and quote it to harm you or destruct you or cause you to destroy yourself. Kenneth Hagin talks about the time he was ill. You know, he had heart issues. He laid down. He was dying, really. He was on his deathbed. And he said that this, a thought seemed to float in his mind, you know, for it is appointed unto man to die. That was how it was quoted. It is appointed to die. And then there was a continuation. I'll paraphrase that part. I said, and today is your own time to die. It's paraphrased. Now, yes, does the scripture say there's for it's appointed unto man wants to die, and after that, there's judgment? That's talking about a phenomenon that happens to all men, but it's not talking about a timing, that it is time to die today. But, you know, he sounded like scripture, his mind was there preparing to die, and then he said something else floated, seemingly from inside of him. For with long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. He said it sounded very quiet at first. He could have missed it. But then he paid attention to it. And that dawned on his heart that was God. And the other one, the first one, was not of God. It was actually the devil trying to deceive him into accepting his fate and dying. Amen. So the devil knows how to quote scripture. But if we are proactive in our own quoting of scripture, it trains us to know how scripture really sounds out in context, not out of context. So one of the ways of training your mind is to speak the word to yourself. Number three, training your mind. Number three, listen to faith-building messages. Listen to faith-building and nourishing messages. I know many of us, I like to listen to songs. But don't just listen to songs. Hello? That's what we listen to, songs all day. Don't just listen to songs. Listen to faith-building messages. It's so important. Listen to messages that build your faith. Now, on the internet these days, there's all sorts. There are things you listen to and you leave more condemned than when you started listening. That's why I qualified it. Faith-building messages, nourishing messages, not just things that tickle your mind and give you more information. That's good. I'm not saying it's not good. But for your own good, listen to faith-building messages. I think it was Kenneth Hagin who said that faith words nourish. There are some things you listen to and you feel nourished. There are some things you listen to, you feel more intelligent, but not necessarily nourished. You feel like you have acquired more facts, but you don't necessarily feel nourished. There's a time for that. There's a time for things that to have, you know, acquire more facts, you know, develop your Bible trivia. There's a time for that. But when it comes to living, you need faith-building messages. And when it comes to renewing your mind, you do need faith-building messages. So one of the ways to train your mind is to listen to faith-building messages, messages that build you up. And then number four, practice the peace of God. Be aware of the kind of thoughts that come through your mind, thoughts that steal your peace. You know, a couple of weeks ago, I was trying to make a decision about how I was going to approach a certain situation that I needed to deal with. I was driving and I was thinking, and a thought came to me. I'll do this. And immediately that thought came, it sounded like an intelligent idea. And immediately I started working on it. You know, we work on thoughts. I started working on it. And I lost my peace. You know? I just got troubled. I just felt, ugh. You know? I said, no, that's not God's way. That's not what God wants me to do. Okay? So I rewound. A skillful thought life is very important as a believer. I'm telling you, after I finish preaching sometimes, many times actually, I go to listen to what I preached, you know. I want to make sure that I didn't come off sounding like, I know it all, now hear me. Okay? And sometimes I do find out I sounded like that, like, you know, especially some tough messages. But when it comes to this and what I preached last week, it's something we're all working on. It's all skillful, being skillful in your thinking, a skillful mind. It's something we're all working on. And we all get ample opportunity to practice. Right? So practicing peace, that really, practicing peace allows you to identify the thoughts that come to steal your peace. But if you don't practice peace, you won't even know when your peace has gone. Because you're in a default state of turmoil, mental turmoil all the time. Even when there's no trouble, you go looking for it. Even when there's no trouble, you just had a good day. Something just feels off, like I should be worrying about something. You go fishing for something to worry about. It's important. Practice peace. Peace is supposed to be your default state. I'm not talking about the peace out here. There will always be something going on out here to trouble you. Always. Jesus slept in a boat in the midst of a storm. That's someone who knew how to practice peace. So your boat can be in the midst of a storm, but you can get skillful in practicing peace inwardly. The Bible says that you should let the peace of God be your umpire. But if you are so far, peace is so foreign to you, how is peace going to lead you? Amen. Peace should not be foreign to you. Right? So practicing peace is one of the ways that we learn to develop a skillful mindset. Okay. All right, so practice the peace of God. We learn to train our minds for a skillful mindset. This number five goes, tandem with that. It says, pay attention to your thoughts and immediately address the ones that steal your peace. Don't let your mind gather thoughts without addressing them. Don't let your mind just gathering input from anywhere and everywhere without addressing them. There are times you need to stop and say, no, that's fear. That's fear. No, I stop you. Oh, no, that's worry. Oh, no, that's envy. No, that's pride. Give them a label, address them. Pay attention to the thoughts that you are having and immediately address them. These things are very consequential for our lives, our relationships. You know, there are people here, you are never present. With your spouse, with your children. Why? Because there's so much going on in your mind that you don't deal with. I had an opportunity to practice this last week. I went all the way to St. Louis to see my daughter. But there were certain issues I was trying to work out, work-related, ministry-related, that were very pressing issues that I'd been kind of trying to figure out and think through and pray through and say, this is what I would recommend, this is what we should do. And I got to St. Louis, after taking the time to get to St. Louis, to be with my daughter for a couple of days, I land there and these thoughts want to hijack my time. The few hours, the few days, couple of days, these thoughts wanted to hijack my time with her, my time there. I had to use all my skills in thinking that, no, I put that aside. When I get back to Chicago, we'll deal with this, right? But do you see how not being skillful in your thinking hijacks moments in your life? And it seems trivial until you begin to see the effects on relationships, on your life, on your ability to walk in God's word, on the way you worry, on your mental well-being. Amen. So this is very important. So today, for the next few minutes, I want to continue talking about this, and my topic for today is similar to last week. It's excellence, a way of life that stems from thinking excellently. Excellence. A way of life that stems from thinking excellently. In Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8 to 9, God says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." This was God speaking. It's like my thoughts are so much, like as heaven, that's infinitely higher than your thoughts. As a result of that, my ways are higher than your ways. Higher thoughts lead to higher ways. Higher thoughts lead to higher actions, right? Higher thoughts lead to better decision making. So many times we read this and say, yes, I said it. you know? Yes, that's why he's God. But then that's why he wrote a whole book, so that you can see the way he thinks, so that you can see his ways. He said, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. But you know what? You can have you can have insight into my thoughts. And that's why I have given you my word. To think better thoughts, to have a better mindset, we need to continually expose ourselves to God's thoughts, which he hasn't held from us. He hasn't kept them from us. He started speaking in Genesis, and he kept speaking and speaking and speaking all the way through Revelation. Now, it's not every word in the Bible that was spoken by God. Amen. In the Bible, you have God's thoughts expressed, God's ways expressed. You also have human thoughts expressed, human ways expressed. You even have the words of the devil in the Bible. Amen. So when you are reading your Bible, you need to know which one. You need to take it in context. That's why you need to understand the Bible. You need to know which ones were spoken by God. You know, you need to know which ones were men's opinion of what they thought God was like. Amen. You need to understand the character of God so that you can understand the words of God. And you do so by interacting with his word more. The highest form of thinking is thoughts that align with God's word. The Bible says in the book of Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Someone pray for my iPad. Opening it. Okay. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. He says, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. I find out that the only words or thoughts that pass that litmus test are God's words. Amen. It's the word of God that can pass. This is a very tight requirement. Things that are true, at the same time noble, at the same time just, at the same time pure, at the same time lovely, at the same time of good report, any virtue, anything praiseworthy. It's only God's word that fits that, meets the requirements there. So to think higher thoughts, you need to think God word-based thoughts. Those are the excellent ways of thinking. Bible says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 to 2, it says, if then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting on the right hand of God. Set your mind on those things above, not on things on the earth. Okay? Setting my mind on things above doesn't just mean that I'm sitting somewhere and just thinking about heaven. And there are times we do so. It's good. Heaven is our hope. Heaven is in our future. Heaven is where we are headed. Amen. But the things above are the things of the word. Set your mind on the things of the word and not on things on earth. You know, when you think about your opinion and perspective about things, let them be word-based. And the ones that you are not sure of yet, keep research, keep digging into the word, so that your opinion about things, the way you think, your mindset about things, are based on God's word. All right. So let me talk about areas where you should become skillful in your thinking. First of all, when we talk about that word skillful, we are talking about something that you've practiced to get better at. You know, you weren't born with it. You may have been born with raw material in some things, but to really become skillful, you practice. Amen? It doesn't happen automatically. I have a child who is an artist. And when she was younger, you know, one day she made me realize that she didn't like it when people say, oh, I think, what did she say? You are just so gifted. You know, oh, you are so gifted. Oh, I already pointed out which is. I have just two genders. So, yeah. I said, so you are, oh, you are so gifted. You are so good at this. You are so gifted. You know, and I would say it a lot. Then she said that, look, that it downplays the part of practice. That it doesn't, that, yeah, maybe I'm gifted. I said, you are gifted because I no matter how much I practice, you know, some one day we did a competition. Let all of us draw a man. Amen. Don't tell my husband that I said this. But, oops. I think he, anyway, I was second to last. But there was still someone after me. And then we concluded that whatever, wherever this girl got it from, it wasn't from us. Maybe some grandparents somewhere, whatever. So, yeah, I said, there's gifting there. But she said, I practice. I spend hours practicing. And that's how I become better and better. That's why I get good at it. When you are going to, if you are going to get skillful at anything, you may have some raw materials, but you have to practice. To get skillful at thinking right, you have to practice. So some of the areas you may want to practice thinking right in. Number one, the way you think about yourself. You see, you have a lot of help to think the wrong way about you. You have a lot of help. Even you have helped yourself. You've helped yourself in the mistakes you've made in life, in the wrong decisions you've made in life, in the naughty, naughty things you've done, right? And naturally, we could go through life thinking about ourselves based on some of the mistakes we've made, some of our past, some of the things people have said about us, and the things the devil tells you every morning. You wake up in the morning, and the first thing that comes to your mind is some mistakes you made the day before. And the way you think about yourself is based on the mistakes you made the day before. Practice thinking about you the way God thinks about you. How does God think about you? He has said it in His Word. He says you are His righteousness in Christ Jesus. You know what that righteousness means? It means that you have been given a nature that's just like Jesus. Think of yourself in that light. You see, this is an area that I've had to practice and practice and practice and practice. Amen. Until when I woke up in the morning, the first thing that came to my mind was not the things I need to improve on today. I don't know, maybe it's worse with certain personalities, but it was really bad with me. I would wake up with the feeling of all the things I should have done better yesterday. Are there, yes, there's a lot of room for improvement. Oh, as I stand before you right now, there's a lot of room for improvement. And as I'm looking at you, as pretty as you look, I know there's a lot of room for improvement. But should that be foremost on your mind? We think it should. Someone put it like this. Someone said that. We keep hoping to dress up the old man enough to feel good about him. In other words, now the old man has been taken out of the way, but there's still an imprint of the old man in our behavior, in the way we act, in the way we talk. I will want to dress that old man up enough to be satisfied with him before we are satisfied with ourselves. But God knows that we can never get there. I'm telling you, if you could help yourself, Jesus would not have come. Jesus came because you can't help yourself. Amen. And then he dealt with the most important part about you because you can't help yourself. He made you a new man on the inside. Practice thinking like he did. Amen. And you can use your words to help you. Wake up in the morning, say, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You know, some time ago, someone was telling me about somebody that, I mean, whose words are very consequential in their lives and all. And they were talking about the way that person looks at them, that blah, blah, blah. I was like, how can you open your mouth to express this? That, oh, when he or she or whatever sees me, this is what they think. Even if they think it, don't open your mouth to say it. There are certain lights you should never see yourself in, no matter who sees you that way. Maybe you grew up with parents that just every day they practiced reducing you to zero every morning and thought that was the best way to train you. And as a result, every time you make a mistake, you do something, you think about your shortcomings, you reduce. You don't need their help anymore. You, of your own accord, reduce yourself to zero. Retrain your mind. Think better thoughts about yourself. Someone says, what should I think about myself? Open your, why don't you open your Bible? Amen. Why don't you open your Bible and start from the epistles and start seeing how God has decorated you, how he has remade you, how he has invested so much in you. Let's go to, oh, wow. Looking at the time, I can't. Oh, okay, maybe we won't go there. Let me just go to the second point. I won't even touch the third point this morning. Let me wrap up. Okay, number one, be skillful in how you think about yourself. Don't practice pulling yourself down. Don't practice condemnation. You know, it's a practice. What you practice, you get better at. If you practice condemnation, you get very, very good at it. You get so good at it that even when people pay you compliments, you don't believe them. 300 people may say, oh, wow, I love how you look today. I love how you look today. I love how you look today. Then one person, maybe they are beefing you. One person now says, oh, what's wrong with your eyebrow? And you latch onto that, and that's what you think about all day. Practice not doing that. Everybody hates me. Everybody hates me. No, four people hate you. The rest of people love you. Practice focusing on the people that love you. Naturally, you'll think about the people that hate you. Naturally. So you practice not focusing on that. We have bad habits that come packaged with us as human beings. You practice not falling down to that level and rising up to the level of the word in your thinking, in how you think about yourself. Practice thinking the way God thinks about you. Number two, be skillful in how you think about others. You know, in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, towards the end of that chapter, the Apostle Paul was talking about many different giftings in the body of Christ, and then he said, covet the best gifts. And then he says, yet I show you a more excellent way. And then it goes on to chapter 13. And we do know that the Bible was not written in verses and chapters and all. Bible, you know, scriptures were broken down that way to make it easier for us to, you know, read and all. So you can read 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and flow into 13. So when Apostle Paul almost ended 12 with a comma, so to speak, I'll show you a more excellent way. And then he goes on to chapter 13 and starts to talk about love. So love is a more excellent way. Amen. Glory be to Jesus. There's no way we can talk about excellence as believers and not talk about love. Amen. Not just self-love, self-love, self-love. I love myself, I love myself, I love myself. Good for you and good for me too. But in our relating with others. But you know what? Practice loving others in the way you think about them. In the way you think about people. In the way you jump to conclusions about people's actions. You know, I find out that the first thing that comes to your mind, I mean, stop. Practice not grabbing the first thought that comes to your mind as an explanation for someone's actions. Practice not doing that. It's called jumping to conclusions. Amen. And many times we jump into a ditch. We jump into a ditch, we ruin that relationship. We jump to a lot of conclusions. And many times those conclusions are not loving conclusions. I wish our tendency to jump to conclusions would lead us to jump to good conclusions. Isn't it interesting that most conclusions we jump to are not good? Amen. Especially in the day of Instagram, the internet. Oh, your mind can grab a conclusion so fast. Which on a more serious note, sometimes the reason we don't reach out to people, we see a picture and we conclude their lives are perfect. We don't pray for people. Why should I pray for you? You are living a better life than I am. Why? Ah, I saw your picture and I've concluded. I have seen a picture and written a whole book. You sent a message to somebody, they left you on, what do they call, pause? Or on read. Practice not jumping to conclusions. What else? What could be going on in their lives? And what things could they be dealing with? Immediately, I see, okay, is that it, the way it is now, okay. When they needed me. Jump to all sorts of conclusions. Husband and wife. Practice not jumping to conclusions. Amen. And what did I say? You get skillful in what you practice. If you practice jumping to conclusions, let's talk about marriage. If you practice jumping, you will always fight. Because there are 101 reasons why he came home late. How come your mind first went to that one? Amen. And vice versa. Whatever it is, men jump to conclusions about concerning their wives. Now practice thinking right about people. The Bible says love believes. 1 Corinthians chapter 32 says love believes the best. Practice it. Now, when I say practice, I recognize the fact that it's not easy and it doesn't come naturally. In fact, you could be as silly, you could do this, you could be as silly as to say, I'm practicing thinking well about David. And the devil will tell you I'm being silly. You are practicing. A child who is learning to walk is being silly, falling down and standing again and still trying it. Stand, fall down, and they have the, they have the courage to stand up. They have the audacity to feel they could get better by trying it again. Isn't that silly? You fell down, stay down, yet he stands up. So practicing means, yes, after you said, I'll think well about David, I'll think about, you still think some ugly thoughts. 15 minutes later, you catch yourself. Don't condemn yourself. I'm practicing. Okay, if those 15 minutes, God has, put it under the blood. Let's try again. That's how you get good at anything. You practice, and you find out you start getting more skillful. That's it. There's no excellence without excellence in your thinking. Stinking thinking, rubbish thinking, thinking that does not align with God's word, does not lead to an excellent life. It may lead to more money. You may be able to get away with it and have more money, have more whatever or what. But as far as God is concerned, that is not excellent. Amen? Let's finish with Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, and then. Yeah, it says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that's written in it, for then you'll make your way prosperous and you'll have good success. You see that word good? Not just any kind of success. Not just any kind of, not success that looks good to man, but to God doesn't amount to much. But where does it start? By the law, the book of the law was what they had then. But we have the entire Bible. We have the word. Don't let it depart from your mouth. Let it mold your thinking. You know, there are some scriptures here. Please rise up to your feet so you can make me stop. Dulce said something during Summer Blast about things he has on his phone that he just goes to about I am, things that God says he is, you know? So when he did that, I said, you know what, instead of every time I go pull up a note or go to the Bible, I just started and pinned a book from my notebook on my screen. So when I'm, the time I would otherwise have gone on Instagram to get more stuff into my brain that maybe I don't need, to jump to more conclusions about more people. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with what? Social media handled with care. Amen. The poor mental health some people are having is a result of the way they handle social media. You get there, you see someone's life, and then now your life is terrible. You know, now your life is not worth it. Why? Because you are comparing yourself to somebody else. But anyway, the time I would do that, I go and click on it, and I have scriptures to meditate on. I've put together scriptures here. I have to meditate on. It helps me to, get more skillful in my thinking. You will reap the rewards of a skillful thought life if you put the work and energy into it, if you put the effort into it. Amen? Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, God, for your word, your life-giving word. Father, we thank you for the different things you have impressed on the hearts of different people today. We know we all have different areas that you are working with us on. And Lord, I ask, oh God, that your people by your Spirit receive your help today to do those things that they have heard. Thank you, Heavenly Father. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come put your hands together for Jesus. Hallelujah.